seminar session at CEF. Those of you who are on live stream, I'm Joachim von Braun from the Center for Development Research. I'm very pleased to welcome those who are not in the room as well, and I hope technology works. I'm very pleased to welcome our two featured speakers today. Dr. Usman Badiane is the Africa Director of the International Food Policy Research Institute based in Dakar, Senegal. Usman, this is not your first visit to CEF. It's great to have you again here. I also warmly welcome Dr. Stefan Schmitz, the Deputy Director General of the German Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development, the BMZ. Dr. Schmitz is also in charge of the One World No Hunger investment initiative, which heavily focuses on progress and nutrition in Africa. We will have two presentations. Usman Badiane will speak to a PowerPoint, Stefan Schmitz will give remarks from the perspective of the BMZ and the One World No Hunger initiative. The document before us is called Nourished, how Africa can build a future free from hunger and malnutrition. The document has also been published in German now, NEAT. It should be an exclamation mark behind it. Those of you who would prefer to ask questions in German are welcome to do so. Usman Badiane is fluent in German. He studied in Germany and got his PhD at University of Kiel before he moved to the International Food Policy Research Institute, the World Bank, worked on Africa and the so-called CADEP agenda, a leading player, as Usman Badiane, in shaping the food and agricultural policy in Africa over the past two decades. We will have a fairly tight agenda because Stefan Schmitz needs to catch a flight and will leave us at 12 o'clock. Thank you that you made it possible to squeeze this into your very busy agenda. You can imagine that at this stage, when German government has just been re-established, formalized, and lots of things are happening, we as the voters want to see change always, so the political system currently responds, including in development policy. But there's also continuity. The same minister, the esteemed Dr. Müller, is in office, but I'm sure he has new ideas for the next period of his role in office. Usman, I ask you to step up here. We want to keep this rather informal. Let me just, while you we stand here shoulder to shoulder, underline that Usman Badiane and I are the co-chairs of the Malabo Montpellier panel, a group of African and European researchers, policy advisors, and thinkers, which focus on strengthening food and agriculture and nutrition policy in Africa in partnership with African organizations and African countries. This panel understands itself as an independent think tank and has started well. It is financially supported by the African Development Bank, the German federal ministry and the British aid agency. A widely spread donor support base, for which we, as you are present here, Dr. Schmitz, are grateful to the German government for this support. Usman, you have the floor, and I ask you to warmly welcome our first speaker.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you again for the introduction. Thank you, Dr. Schmitz, and thank you everybody for attending this meeting. Let me quickly go into the outline because we have a very tight schedule. I want to talk about the background to this report, so you have a little bit of a understanding of how different the angle is that we're using towards our work on the Malabo-Montpellier panel. Then I will talk about the role of the panel and why we are searching for lessons. We do that because we think it's always good to learn from positive change so that we can scale up and replicate what's happening. And in the case of Africa, in the case of nutrition, particularly why it is important to learn, right? And what we try to do at the panel is to understand the positive change that's taken on the ground, that's taking place across Africa, and to distill lessons that can be used for scaling up and replication so that that positive change can be amplified over time, accelerated, and spread. So in the particular report that you have, we were asking, or we did three things. We looked at where there was progress in Africa in nutrition, and we tried to understand what the critical factors are for it, and we draw key recommendations. It will be a little bit clearer. Let me talk about the background of this report. Learning from positive change. For many of us who have been dealing with growth and development in Africa, the last 20 years are markedly different from anything that happened since the 60s. That is the first time that you had sustained growth and spread growth across Africa. Between the 90s and the 2000s, African countries have raised the level of expenditure in agriculture on an annual basis by almost another 100%, double, 86% to be exact. Agricultural domestic product increased by nearly two-thirds. So something is happening, and we want to understand what that was. If you have an environment like that, and you want to grow faster because you have big issue with poverty and a lot of other needs, then you better understand what happened here and how you can learn from that. Learning from positive change is also important to see where there is progress. There are always lessons to be learned. In terms of poverty reduction, in terms of reducing malnutrition, from the 90s again to the 2000s, Africans have brought down the share of poverty by 36%, and the level of malnutrition, depending on which indicator you use, they've reduced by between 20 and 43%. Very different from the decades prior. Even in terms of growth, African countries actually, for the first time, have grown stronger, not just than the world average, but also than the BRICS since the 90s. So there's a lot of dynamism there. And if you have that, and you're starting from a very low basis, and you have so much else to do, it is important to understand what went right so that you can do it better. And why do you need that? Because despite all that resurgent growth, poverty is still high. We are coming from a long way, and therefore we can't be satisfied with the progress. But how do you amplify that progress? How do you spread it? And here's why we are where we are. You look at this graph, Africa did well in the 60s. Nobody worried about Africa in terms of poverty and hunger in the 60s, and suddenly everything fell through the floor. So there are two decades from the late 60s, early 70s, all the way to the mid 90s, things just went downhill. Okay. So much so that when the growth that we're talking about came back, when this growth came back, which is very strong, but to catch up, because we've lost here, to catch up from where we would have been if you had not lost the 70s and 80s, we'll have to double the growth rate that we're having now. So this is our trajectory. By 2025, you'll have per capita GDP in agriculture of 1,200. We would have been at almost 2,000 if we didn't have this lost decade. So therefore, although we're doing well here, we're way beyond below where we would have been. There's so much catching up that we need to do. So growing fast now, growing better than the breaks, 6%, that's just not enough because you've lost so much, okay? You're very far away from where you could have been. Nice. Okay. What I was going to show in this picture, I don't know why it looks like this, is that for the first time, so many countries are growing and growing faster. This map was going to show you a lot of light colors, light green, light yellow colors. And the darker the color of a country, the higher the growth rate. So in the 2000s, more countries are growing. So therefore, more countries growing faster than ever. But the progress, as you can see by the different colors, is uneven. And the challenges we're facing are still large, right? You've seen just the poverty numbers that I talked about. So some countries doing better than others and doing things perhaps right. So therefore, there's something to learn surely. If somebody's doing things better than you, is your neighbor, you want to know what they're doing. And that's where we come in. What we try to do here is to provide evidence to feed into a dialogue for people to learn and understand what's going right around the countries and replicate success. Okay? So we have the panel here. We try to, whatever the thematic issue is, we happen to talk about nutrition today. The next report is going about mechanization. The report after that could be small scale irrigation, could be trade, could be agribusiness. Whatever it is, we're asking ourselves, where is progress taking place in Africa? Which are the leading countries? What works and why and how it works in those countries? And then try to draw lessons from that. Once we do that, we take it now to the forum, which is the twin program to the panel, or the twin activity. Here, we are experts who try to do this. There, we bring leaders at the ministerial level, at the program secretarial level, to discuss now what has come out here, where are things working, why is it working, and how is it working. So we get those countries that are leading the pack next to other countries that will need to learn from them, but at the highest level. It is important because the ministers and permanent secretaries are those who set the direction of what happens in countries. You can have very good technical folks, but if the minister and permanent secretary doesn't share the same vision, they cannot give the same direction. We don't expect them to be experts. We don't expect them to be doing technical work, but we want them to understand, to see that things are working and why they work and how to work so they can get inspired. So we bring them together, create a space for dialogue, to exchange and to learn mutually, to engage decision makers at all these different levels so that they can somehow be less intimidated by the size of the challenge, because they're encouraged by seeing somebody facing the same challenge and being able to solve the problem. So here are the members of the panel, Professor Von Braun and myself are the co-chairs of the panel. Here are the co-chairs of the forum, who bring together, convince the meeting with ministers and permanent secretaries, the Right Honorable Vice President of the Republic of Malawi, and the Minister of State in charge of planning and development of the Republic of Benin. So now to the report, Nourished. Malnutrition comes in many forms and many ways. So includes stunting, includes wasting, includes obesity, and we're looking at all these different forms of malnutrition and how people have been able to reduce that. And we all know how costly malnutrition can be for any country. in terms of what it does as an impediment to growth, affecting cognitive development, feature-like opportunities, and the contribution to growth itself. So that is one of the reasons why this has been the first topic that we looked at. So in the spirit of the panel and the forum, trying to understand where positive change is taking place, so what we ask ourselves is, in the case of nutrition, where are the countries that are making the most progress across Africa? What do they do, right? How do they do it? And why does it work there? So that you can pick examples from that. And we looked at the countries that are leading the pack. And here we have between 40 and 60% or 56% reduction between 2010 and 2016 in the Global Hunger Index as computed by IFPRI. Remarkable progress. So what did they do? If I'm a country that would like to have faster progress against malnutrition, I should be interested by what they did. So that's why, as the panel, we're focusing on bringing that to light. And here is, again, the status of those countries' progress against malnutrition. And these are the top that we focused on in our report. So we did case studies in all these countries to look at what they did to make progress in all these different areas. Then it came out that what they did could be looked at in terms of policy level factors, institutional level factors, and programmatic level factors. In terms of the policy, in all those countries, they have elevated nutrition to a top policy priority, all the way to the president's office very proactively, or the vice president's or the prime minister's office. It's become a national thing of a national interest. They want to make progress, and you'll see the examples when you talk about that. At the institutional level, they created synergy, get everybody galvanized around making sure that nutrition works. At the programmatic level, they targeted and invested and went all the way to the community levels. Basically, they aligned all those different three dimensions to be able to deliver. Here are examples of policy and institutional measures. In Cameroon, they integrated food security and nutrition in national health strategies very early on in the country, so they may connect the connection. They created an interdepartmental community on food security, a parliamentarian network on nutrition, started regulating breast milk substitute, fortification policy, maternity leave policies. So they're setting up all the things right to get everybody's attention about nutrition, but also get the framework right for that. In the case of Rwanda, they adopted a national food and nutrition policy, an intersectoral nutrition committee, including the private sector and the civil society organization, had a national multisectoral strategy to eliminate malnutrition at the national level, with departmental level or district level, at the lowest level of the administration, they needed to have a plan to reduce malnutrition. And they had a protocol for the management of malnutrition and the optimal feeding of infants and children. All these are policy or institutional documents or actions, but what it has now, it creates a possibility for content. And that content comes in the programmatic work. And for that, we have extracted from the report examples from Angola and Senegal. The case of Angola, that just came out of a civil war, they had community-based management of acute malnutrition among children under 5. So surveillance and looking at them and then taking action to see what happens. Supplementary feeding program, deworming and distribution of vitamin A supplements targeting those children. Having a hospital initiative on breastfeeding to make sure it's practice well. Providing iron folic acid supplementation to pregnant women. And carrying a nutrient surveillance program around the country to be able to track and address malnutrition very early on and at the local level. Senegal had a similar approach, had a countrywide program where kids are being weighed from birth to age 3, providing nutrition education to the young mothers, community-based solutions. In every little tiny corner, there is a lady who is in charge of working with the other ladies in the community to understand what's happening to the children, to be able to figure out, even if there's a little bit of shame to not tell, the neighbors will know that there's something happening in this house and to the kids. Providing fortified food for moderate malnutrition in those cases of kids. If it's acute, there was a program to refer them to hospital and do intensive care so that it works. They provided mosquito nets, iron and vitamin A supplements in the communities, and promoted community gardens to diversify the food. So after the institutional and the policy umbrella, then you go programmatic and you get those things done at the local level. Okay. So the recommendations, drawing from all the examples, and in the report, of course, you have more. We have 6 country case studies. And if you go to the website, we have case studies, fact sheets on other countries that will also give you quite a lot of interesting information on how they did that. We have more recommendations. Because there's not enough time, I decided just to focus on this 8. What they did right, all of those 6 countries, the reduced malnutrition by 40 to 6%, is elevating nutrition to a top policy priority. There was somewhat of an outrage. It shouldn't be happening if we don't want to tolerate it somehow. In different degrees, but there has been that kind of a motivation. Working in broad partnerships across government, but also with the private sector and civil society organizations. Strengthening food system regulations, bringing fortification, safety, and controlling the quality of food that's being provided. Capturing agriculture, water, health, and education to bring them together into the program. Mainstreaming nutrition education. A lot of people are not nourished well because they don't know. Some don't because they cannot afford, but a lot don't because they just don't know. Especially if you have to raise kids from 0 to 59 months, you may be doing things by convention, what uncle did or aunt did, but there's a lot of other things that could be done there. Having data, it's a new dimension now, so you can better target, better monitor, better surveil what's happening on the ground. Empower the communities. You can do nutrition at a top level. It is, at the end of the day, a household issue. It's a personal issue between a mother and a child or within the household. So the communities have been brought into that. And they started now understanding the issue of obesity, and they're bringing that into the program. There are more, there are 12 recommendations of that. You can read them in the report, but these 8, I wanted to elevate. But what we discovered also in the report, and we want to draw the attention of those successful as well as those less successful countries, that they are threats to nutrition as well. You can be doing well now, but conflicts can bring everything down again. Climate change, because of its threat to the production system, is an issue. We see those 2 threats out there that could be impacting the pace of progress over the next few years. So that much to the report. You can download it from the website. I think the German version is going to be there very soon, and the English version is there. You can follow us on Twitter. There's a lot of interesting things that we do on the panel. And here are the website. So thank you for your time, and I'm ready for your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Osman, for this energetic report on the opportunities, threats, and risks. Let me underline again, what is new is really that 3 things need to come together. Policy, institutional change, and programmatic actions. You cannot leave any of the 3 out. Working at the programmatic level, having the beautiful isolated project focusing on nutrition will not have the impact at country level, which we identified at the country case studies of successful countries. Simply pontificating from policy leadership and leaving out the programmatic or the institutional reforms, bringing ministries and agencies together, will not do the trick. So I think these are very important lessons also for development cooperation officials, that a focus on the programmatic level needs to be supplemented, augmented with initiatives of highest level policy dialogue and support to trigger action at the policy and institutional level. I know this is where you always want to be, and where you see the German and international development cooperation forces to place themselves. You have played a key role to put nutrition on the agenda in the G7 framework, for instance. That is highest level in the Sustainable Development Goal framework, and at the G20, where Germany played a role to put the nutrition food security agenda at the highest level, and we can applaud you for playing a key role with these initiatives. You have the floor. Thank you. Welcome, Mr. Schmidt.
Thank you very much, Professor von Braun, for your kind, for your very, very kind introduction, and for giving me a very nice link to what I now want to present very shortly. First of all, I'm very happy, always very happy, to have ZEF here as a strong partner in Bonn. Really, it is more than just that we have offices only a few hundred meters away. Over the years, we established a very strong intellectual and political exchange network, work together on very different projects, and we are always happy to be able to provide financial support to ZEF. Why we are happy to have such a strong development-oriented and internationally-oriented partner here, here in Bonn. And over the years, that was always very, very fruitful and very helpful for us to have staff here accompanying us on the way forward, on the political way forward. Indeed, when I take a look back over the last 10 years, there has been a lot of progress. A lot of progress in terms of simple figures, what already has been done. And a progress, I would say, in broadening the scope. I remember about 10 years ago when I entered into that work on food security and agriculture. On the peak of the food price crisis. At that time, in the G7, that was absolutely focused on one question only: how can we improve production and productivity? Very, very, very clear, very narrow. That was a good starting point. Mm-hmm. Something had to be done at that time. But now the problems we are facing right now, the whole issues around nutrition, malnutrition, as far as going to obesity, and now when we see what is in SDG2, for example, so there has been progress over the last 10 years. And now it is still unfinished business. We made progress. Business as usual now is not an option. And while we have unfinished business, new problems are rising, and now we have to accelerate one step again and make it political. Not just staying on the programmatic level, as you nicely phrased that, but now scaling it up in a broadest sense, make it an institutional issue, a political issue. And having taken a look at this picture with the members of this Malabo panel, I would say members like that, people like that, they are game changers They are the champions in moving this very comprehensive agenda of food security, of nutrition forward. As I said, business as usual is not an option. We need somehow a transformation of the global agriculture and food system. Something in general needs to be changed to make it more inclusive, addressing all these forms of problems we have, and make it more political. I think the SDG 2, when you take a look at it, what is in it, it is very nicely enshrined the various dimensions of the challenge. So as the right now the food system is not healthy for people as it is. Too many people are not well nourished, and at the same time the food system is not healthy for the planet. In many places of the world, agriculture in its current form is a main driver of soil degradation, deforestation, exploitation of freshwater resources. And we need to integrate it into it, make it people-centered and for the people, and at the same time for the planet, with an integrated approach. And as we are convinced and see that the figures are quite clear, the majority of people suffering hunger, malnutrition, people are in poverty, it happens in the rural world. And at the same time, it is the rural areas where the natural resources I was talking about need to be preserved and used in a sustainable way. So we need to bring these dimensions together. And that was it. Ecology and natural resource management. And that is far more than greening the farm economy. Of course, that is a key point, but regional concepts are necessary. For example, regional forest management, soil and water management, economic and technological change, and political and cultural change. Now, that is becoming more and more. So we are convinced these three aspects, putting that into the, or looking at it through the lens of rural development, that is exactly where we want to go and where we now, in the second phase of the One World No Hunger Initiative, want to go. Make it political and make it comprehensive. Yes, now we are happy to have a new German government here, and we have a very clear indication that there is now a second phase of this One World No Hunger initiative that was launched 3 years ago. And this is exactly what we want to achieve. Linking all these loose ends we created in the first phase, bringing that together and lift it up, scale it up, strengthen partner dialogue, make it more evidence-based, and so on. I was very grateful, Osman, you mentioned a conflict as one point. We cannot ignore it. Because many problems we want to change, we cannot address in the usual way we design a nice project that in many cases requires at least a minimum of a functioning state of good governance and so, and conflict is really an obstacle in all that. And we have to address that. We need new concepts. And at the same time, I now remember for at least 20, 30 years, we were talking about that we will fight the wars of the 21st century will be wars on water, for example. why there is not nowhere now a big war on water. But if you take a closer look and on local and regional conflicts, at least in the dry lands, the arid areas, it is of course on water. Is this one of the driving force? And here, regional concepts, sustainable use of water. So we can add to and play a role ourselves in contributing to conflict management and to our contribution to a better world and more peace. Now I said a little bit on the why we are sitting here and why we are doing it and what we want to achieve, and now only a few more sentences on the how question. So it's more than on the how, two steps on the programmatic level and on the institutional level. We take it, and that's one of the points where I'm very grateful to Lev, and in particular to Professor von Braun. He was, for me, he was an eye-opener, making it clear that the future of the development, future Africa, must be knowledge-intensive and no longer capital-intensive. That was my takeaway from many discussions we had. And to make that shift, this progress towards sustainability, towards feeding the world today and in the future, is on using better knowledge, make it knowledge intensive. And we have started a lot of programs, for example, on the Green Innovation Centers. It's one of our flagship programs in many countries, accompanied by other programs on nutrition specific programs, and programs on soil management, for example, and land rights. Now we get that together, we want to strengthen that, and in particular strengthen this idea of the Green Innovation Centers, to build these centers as growing knowledge hubs, not just for more productivity, but at the same time for better food, healthy food, and production that preserves the resources, and putting that in a broader concept of growing political dialogue and so giving support to institutional development and institutional change. So that is what we want to achieve over the next 4 years. Happy to be able to be part of that, and happy to have Steph as one very strong partner in that. Thank you very much.
Please sit down there. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Schmitz, for remarks, also for giving us a heads up what's in the making with the future of the One World No Hunger Initiative. Colleagues, both of our speakers did not only talk about opportunities and positive change, but hinted at climate risks and climate threats. Let me emphasize what the Malabo-Montpellier panel had said about addressing the threat of conflict, which Usman also mentioned. Our point there was African governments and non-state actors need to recognize that civil conflict adds a new set of challenges to reducing malnutrition, and that interventions including diplomacy, security actions, and emergency aid will be required. I'm mentioning that in order to underline that we are not shying away from addressing those issues of conflicts and war in Africa, which happen to capture the headlines in Europe more than it deserves. The emphasis of our report is not to neglect this, to call for considered political actions by state and civil society actors,
while the report emphasizes the progress and the opportunities to learn in particular. Among those issues on the ground are the growing issues not only of water conflicts but of cattle raiding. That has become, and we have discussed this in the Malabo Montpellier panel, stealing animals with an AK-47 has become so widespread, and that essentially is a conflict over land. So land rights, land policies, women's rights to land, and the issues of land rights of pastoralists are at the root cause of some of these conflicts. I'm sure many of you have questions to ask. We have 20 minutes of presence still of Dr. Schmitz. Usman will be here for most of the remaining day. So feel free to address your questions to our speakers. Who would like to start? If you are slow starting, I will ask a question, but please go ahead. There are hands coming up. Technically, shall we hand out micros or will it be listened to?
I don't know. I think it will be fine, right?
Yeah, but we want those people on live stream to also hear you.
Sorry.
If you step out and half turn to the camera, and then the word sees you.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
And say who you are.
Yeah. I'm Alpha. I'm a doctoral student here in ZEF. I only have one question, actually. Like Professor von Braun already emphasizing on high level political policy for African without hunger, maybe. But I want to ask how far the political commitment and political agreement in Africa between the leaders in Africa, and how then Germany government have encouraged, or maybe not encouraged, but facilitated this political agreement in Africa. Thank you.
Great. I suggest we collect a few questions. Thank you, Alpha. Please pass on to your neighbors.
Thank you very much. My name is Hannah Jenke. I'm working here at ZEF and also at the Horticulture Department of the University of Bonn. My question goes actually to both Usman and Dr. Schmitz. A few years ago, we did a study on nutrition-sensitive agriculture. And we're also looking at some of the good examples where it worked that agriculture could contribute to reducing hunger. And we found, like you found, also that high-level political influence was one of the key drivers to make it successful. But we also found what Professor von Braun said, that without good institutional collaboration, especially between the agriculture and the health ministries, that didn't work. That wasn't enough. And my question is, A, did you observe that as well in your studies? And B, what can be done? And to Dr. Schmitz, is the German government doing something like that, actually, to link the agriculture and the health ministries to have somewhere an influence on achieving SDG 2 or working towards achievement of SDG 2? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Please pass to Oliver.
Yeah, I have two questions. Thank you for your great presentations. When we look at this report, it's a very interesting material, and I really like what it proposes, and looking at the three dimensions that Professor von Braun summarizes, the policy actions and the institutional change, and as well as the pragmatic action. So my question really comes to looking at this in terms of the different sections of the society. Who really, and who and when are the actions and policy initiatives supposed to be done? For example, when you talked about the conflict, that is one dimension, but also there is a huge section of the society that is really vulnerable to this malnutrition issues, the gender dimension, the women and the children. So my question would be like, what are some of the ways and some of the practical actions that you think could really benefit in addressing malnutrition among this very vulnerable group of the society. But when you also talk about the progress that we've seen in the 1990s to the 2000s, that was a very rosy picture of what's happened in Africa. But my big question is on the distributional effects of this growth or these expenditures. Who really benefits from this? How does this change, for example, a 90% increase in expenditure in agriculture, and agricultural growth, where does it go to? Is it really just paying salaries to the employees or really going into the agricultural development and then affecting the sections of the society in a bigger picture?
Thank you. Should we take these three and would you start?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. The political agreement among African leaders, the best way to respond to that is to point to the Malabo agenda, where all 54, now 55 countries have come together and committed to achieving specific outcomes, including ending hunger by 2025, the reason why we started doing nutrition. And they didn't just stop at committing to doing that. They also committed to tracking progress by every country every 2 years at the heads of state level. Every country files a report and the heads of states look at each other and they look at what they did. They just had the first one in January. All 46 countries out of 54 were rated, they got a score overall and in individual areas. And the heads of states were sitting looking at each other and seeing how their countries were doing. They have trade included, gender is included, climate So the commitment is there, right? So I think that they've agreed on the need to get the outcomes, to do what it takes for that. On the Hannah, I think I've tried to very quickly go over that, but if you read in the report, in all these different countries, whether they have intergovernmental staff, interministerial this, whatever it is, there has been a cross-ministerial and sometimes even beyond government, a type of a coordination brought people together. There's no other way you can address nutrition, okay? And that is a transition to Oliver. What triggers is actually is somebody saying, I don't want to see this any longer. It's just as simple. In Rwanda, I don't know which country you're from, but in Rwanda, they saw the Global Hunger Index, and they saw how poorly Rwanda was doing, okay? And the minister was smart enough to take that and then, you know, make noise with it and decide we don't want this any longer. We have to do something about it, right? And that worked. How do you make progress on the ground level? I think Professor Brown talked about it and the report talks about it as well, is working by the communities, with the communities. You see, most of these programs are implemented together with the communities. Could be with the health service at the local level, could be with NGOs, could be with community leaders, but it is done together with them and through them. And I think that's been an important way of having change on the ground. Now, the distribution effect of growth, I tend to say that having fewer less poor is always better than having everybody poor, right? So, and you cannot probably lift everybody at the same time, but by starting to lift some out of poverty, and there's no question that a lot have gotten out of poverty right now. The numbers are big of those who are still poor because population keeps on growing. But you travel around Africa, you see that conditions of living have changed dramatically for a lot of people. Having said that, coming from a place where you had a lot of poor people around, 2 decades of stagnation or decline, it's going to take a lot of time to reach everybody. But if we continue doing what we've been doing over the last 15, 20 years, I think we'll be in a different place. Projections are already saying that by 2030, most African countries will be middle income, and that's going to be enough resources that will allow you to address distribution issues if you were to get there, and not everybody's there. But I would refer you to another report we did just 2 years ago on a middle income Africa and how we get there with everybody. Maybe you can take a look at that and see what it does. So I think we're growing faster. At least now we have the opportunity to distribute. When we're not growing, there was nothing we could do, right? So at least that's the way to look at it, and I think we can be positive about it. And then try and let people understand how they can bring everybody along that train of growth.
Okay.
Thank you. Regarding your question on political will, there is an endless debate in development policy. Should we cooperate with good performers, with those governments with good institutions and political will, or should be more or entirely focused on failing states, poor performer, and lack of political will? We need both sides. We cannot neglect the one or the other. We are happy to be able to support good performers, and there are quite some in Africa. And for example, taking that with the exception of Senegal, all the others that you highlighted in one way or the other, we or other leaders have a very strong lead in giving support. On the other hand, if political will is weak, we cannot neglect the poor and hungry people. But maybe the direct cooperation with governments would not lead far. So in these cases, the cooperation and the support of civil society on the one hand, and participation in multilateral cooperation, I would say that is what we do, and I would say that is best what we can do. We have long-standing experience in giving support and cooperate with multilateral organizations like the World Health Program, and so we see the need for more focused, more strategic work with NGOs. That is something I would say that is one of Resolve's business. We have to do a better job in doing it, and we are happy to receive ideas and concepts from academia in that field. Regarding agriculture and health, I would like to add water and sanitation, that means infrastructure. Take the whole set of, from my perspective, these are the key ministries, key departments when it comes to tackling the issue in a rural setting. With the program on nutrition we launched in 12 African countries 4 years ago, we started that. Until that time, we didn't know anything on nutrition at all. That is a complete new program we started four years ago. Until 2014, we only had bilateral programs on agriculture, but not specific on nutrition. And that is now writing that is new, and we address this issue of cross-departmental work, particular health, water, and sanitation we address. And on the other hand, we are a committed member in the Scaling Up Nutrition Network, the internet network, aiming at putting these issues on a high political level. And I think that is important to have really an international campaign and movement toward that. And the last question on the targeting the vulnerable and marginalized. Again, that is about the same question with what is our key group or target group? Is it more those people who do have who have skills and potentials and are fit for professionalized and modernized agriculture, or should we do more together with vulnerable and marginalized? And again, here, we shouldn't ignore one side. We cannot neglect the poor and marginalized. And again, these now large programs we started on nutrition, that is really targeted towards marginalized, vulnerable groups, young women, breastfeeding mothers, and young children up to the age of school.
Yeah, thank you. I think it can be underlined that you humbly didn't sort of say that German external assistance in Africa in the field of food, nutrition, agriculture has become the biggest investor, adding it all up. So it matters what you strategically do there. We have time for a quick next round, and when you need to sneak out to catch your flight, you just sneak out. We will maybe you listen to these next the next round of questions. I see at least half a dozen hands. Heike was next. Stine, would you give the mic over there? This is not first catch who speaks. I've seen you. Then come over here. Yeah. Questions need to be very brief.
Heike Baumler from CEF. I would like to push you a little bit further on the issue of nutrition-sensitive agriculture that was raised, because I think that is also at the heart of the One World, No Hunger initiative. Because the examples you mentioned of successful programs and policies, they very much related to health interventions, and there were a few examples of agriculture-related interventions. If you look at the AU level, the African Union, a lot of the priorities still go towards staple crop production. And so I would like to know, politically, do you think that there's been progress on really integrating nutrition into agricultural planning?
Clear. Next, please.
Christine Husmann, also from CEF. I wanted to insist on Oliver's question, who benefits, you mentioned, the poorest and marginalized, from the experience of the success stories. I mean, even in these champion countries, malnutrition levels are quite high. So as nutrition is also a relatively new topic, or relatively new, do you think it just needs more time to go further down that road, or do you think to reach those that don't benefit so far, you need different programs, and do you have an idea how they could look like?
Next. Jennifer
Kubik from CEF. I have a question to Usmane Bayanem. You stress a lot the role played by communities in the improvement of nourishment. I would like to ask you if you don't think that it might be simply a sign of inefficiency for public institutions, because maybe the motive would be public institutions like hospitals or clinics or schools that should be responsible for that.
Okay, please pass it right over here.
Well, my question, thank you very much. I'm Janis from CEF as well. My question is, just as the first question was, is the production side solved? Because you stress very much in your report the health and sanitation side. So how important is increasing productivity in the future in these programs? Thank you.
Across the aisle, I think.
Thank you. I'm Andrea Sonntag from WHH. I have two questions. One is, could you elaborate a little bit more on how the lessons learned from the relatively stable countries can be applied to more fragile contexts, because the majority of stunted children are living in those contexts. So how could we create framework conditions beneficial to the reduction of malnutrition in those countries? And the second is to both of you. This year, the post-Cotonou negotiations will start, and EU is quite supportive in the reduction of malnutrition in African countries, and the post-Cotonou agreement will shape trade, political dialogue, development cooperation. So how could this post-Cotonou agreement be shaped to be more supportive to the reduction of malnutrition, and what will be the position of the German government?
Who feels let out?
Oh. Thank you very much for the good presentation. I have a question in regard to the social protection sector and the relevance, because you have looked deeper in the social safety net in Ethiopia, and I didn't find the social protection side in your recommendations. I saw the health sector, wash and so on, agriculture important, but social protection for the most vulnerable and chronic food insecure people, in my opinion, is very important to look at.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Please pass it to somewhere. There were two left out.
Thanks. My name is Ahmed. I'm a PhD student here. I have two interrelated questions. One is, you talked about the increase in agricultural resources, 85%. I wonder whether that was just an increase in resources or an increase in the share of the national resources. The second one related to that is the Maputo 2003 agreement on 10% agriculture of national budgets. Have you done any evaluations to see whether these any of the countries actually meeting these targets locally for the national generated resources? Thank you.
Let me take a cut here and ask Stefan Schmitz on his way out to leave words of wisdom.
Okay, very, very short remark. What your remark on? Increase in productivity remains necessary, but not sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
Not sufficient. It is, comprehensive thinking would be higher productivity plus better diversity. Diversified agricultural production, producing more healthy food. Getting away from this too strong focus on selected value chains.
Mm.
Yeah, that is mainly then on stable food, and that is it. I currently see here the challenge that from many different angles, there is not enough demand for diversifying the production. Yeah, there is lack of knowledge on consumer side. There is lack in the research field. There is lack of political attention to that. I would say that is from many different angles. This is still must be high on the agenda. How to really diversify so that people really ask for it, and that good and nutritious food and healthy food is affordable to people. In many places, it's too expensive, as far as I see. Okay. Sorry for that.
Thank you very much, Usman. You're welcome to be selective.
Okay.
I think the trade issues need to be addressed.
Okay.
From an opportunity and risk issue, and as you are deep in your heart a trade economist, that should be taken up. The social safety net question is relevant. We addressed it in the Ethiopia case study quite extensively, but it's correct, it wasn't sort of in the umbrella 12 recommendations. Please go ahead and pick and choose. And I think we can still round this up with two more questions which I had seen before. And we close. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Integrating nutrition into agriculture, that's sort of the next front, right? It's something that people are working on. But there are timid steps toward that, or even more than timid. The homestead gardens, like you're trying to do in Senegal. Education that people are getting around consuming the healthy food they have. Dr. Schmitz was talking about, it's also a matter of consumption. When I go to my hometown, I see people that want to have baguette and coffee and milk for breakfast, yet the millet-based breakfast is much better, but I don't want that. Right? So it's also a matter of, and if you don't do that, of course you cannot respond, right? So I think that it's a little bit, it's a matter of price, it's a matter of markets, it's a matter of purchasing power, it's a matter of food safety law, so it's more complex than that. But I think that's where people are getting too slowly. Even in the profession, it's recent, right, that we are talking about that. We haven't seen much of it yet, but beyond homestead garden and these kind of things. But biofortification, you cited here, it goes towards that big time. If you get the NARS to produce more micronutrient-dense food, then you're going all the way towards bringing nutrition into agriculture. How do we show the donor benefit? The programs themselves are targeting those who are not benefiting. They are the most vulnerable the most threatened by malnutrition. So you are actually reaching out in the nutrition programs to the people. If we talk about the growth in general, I think it's going to be a vast discussion. So I'll just stop at saying that the nutrition program themselves target those who are the most vulnerable. They're not targeting the better-to-do people. Post-Cotonou decade issues, I think first and foremost, and we did a report on that recently. I publicized the Resnac website a little bit, which is a partner on this Malabo Montpellier panel. I think you've seen in the report their logo. The issue is the opportunity to trade and to compete in the global markets. Those are extremely important for agriculture to thrive. He talked about productivity, he talked about production, the people who need to make a living out of it, the output that needs to happen has to go hand in hand with trade. So I don't know the agenda that's going to happen in that, but it should create a much better trading environment for African countries, which are going to be part of the supply line tomorrow for the rest of the world. So that would be important. Social protection is an umbrella word. What happens in social protection can be very similar to what we see people doing in nutrition, right? You're providing support to people who need access to food. You're distributing supplements to them. You're distributing food quantities to them. You're helping them get the support they need for health and others. That is something we'll find also in social protection. So we can talk about broader social protection issues. And again, I'm going to refer to RESAC's, our annual report this year is going to be on social protection, if you look into that. There's no question that people have access to social safety net are less vulnerable to nutrition. Right? But the programs you're carrying out for better nutrition could be seen as being part of umbrella social protection programs. So I don't see these two being as separate. It's just how wide do you go under social protection in order to solve nutrition? But social protection goes beyond nutrition, right? It's much broader than that. But the nutrition solution is a part of that. Joachim, I think there was a question about hospitals. You cannot solve nutrition with hospitals because by then it's too late because people are already sick, right? You have to do something way before you need to go to the hospital. So, and that's what's really important.
Let me add a brief remark on the trade issues, which really cut across countries and cannot be studied country by country. A simplified argument runs like this. Ooh, Africa imports in agriculture products up to, what is it, 80 billion?
Total is 75 billion.
Yeah.
40.
And it exports maybe 40 around
million.
40. So Africa could do so much better if it wouldn't import so much. It would be by the difference of 40 plus billion richer. This is not a good trade economics. Why is Africa importing so much food nowadays? Is that bad? No, it's not, because it's capable to import much more food and feed its people better. It wasn't capable to do so. It was more self-sufficient 10, 15 years ago. Was it good? No. Lots of more people were starving at the time. So I think we need to come to grips with the trade agenda of Africa. Of course, competitiveness would be, export competitive enhancement would be good in food and agriculture. But the income distributional side of that needs to be looked upon. But then who benefits from that competitiveness? But looking simply at the trade balance, as you find often in colloquial discussions, is not a solid policy.
Can I just add to that, so that I'm sure they're going to hear that argument? It's very common. I get beat up a little bit when I try and correct that. The numbers are the following. From 2014, so African exports went from 10, 11 billion all the way to 40 billion, quadrupled, okay, which is a huge performance. imports from to Africa went from around the same amount again, 10, 11 billion, because it was almost zero deficit in 2004, so went all the way to 75 billion. That's how the Cap of 35 happened, right? But if you look at what's bringing that gap is that if you have population growing and people having more money, they're going to be demanding more food. So the combination of faster growth and faster population growth easily gets you into demand growth rates that are double digit. Agriculture cannot grow by double digit. It's a biological process. It cannot be sustained. You can do maybe 5 or 6% for a while, but you cannot do double digit for, you know, if you have these wild swings, yes, you can do double digit from year to the other, but you cannot sustain double digit like 10 years in agricultural growth. It's just impossible. So therefore, the more the country grows, the more they have the capacity to feed themselves, the more they will import, because local demand is just going to be behind. So what we should be looking at is that, is agriculture growing? Is it growing healthily? Is it creating wealth? Is it employing people? Is it bringing resources to the country? But we will, for the next generation, be importing more than we can produce. I'm sorry, we'll be consuming more than we can produce, right? So we'll have a negative balance trade. But it's a good thing because of what Joachim said. We're feeding people. They don't go to bed hungry.
I believe there are at least two left. Go to your neighbor, Manuel, please. There's one in the back, if it's still up. Yeah. So, and then we close, if that's okay. This is the calm corner here. Okay. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah. My name is Man Moura. I'm from the United Nations University. And I also want to go a little bit deeper on what's mentioned before. And you also hinted about how many nutrition practices are based on convention, independent of availability. And they happen in the household with the decision level. Food culture is heavily dependent on tradition. You also said preference. Did you, in this lessons learned report, do you also look at what happened to make perception change on what is nutritious? Because now in some countries over 50% are better nourished. And there's a lot of research that says that there have to be behavior change. The determinants are not necessarily economic. So can you give any insights on this?
Okay, please pass back to
thank you. My name is Kion. I work at CEF. I like the report because it starts with lessons learned, what you can learn from the positive aspects, because that we have to build on those things. Also, it's good to focus on a broader level. That's nice. But still, something that I'm concerned with or would like to bring to the attention of this forum is that there is always decision that's made by household. Finally, we can talk about innovations or different aspects, and then finally it's the household that decides. And for us, agriculture is important. Okay, we have been talking about production, but it's about household making decision to accept technology or innovation and practice it. In that process, there are lots of problems. For example, I have observed such problems in Ethiopia in many cases, whereby there is a gap between the needs of the farmer and what's coming to them. And also there's a gap between research and then implementation wing. Research produces something, and then there's extension wing, which is not strongly linked to this research. Mm-hmm. That's my observation based on one country, but this is a continental report. Mm-hmm. And is this challenge considered, or is it to be considered? Because maybe we may narrow this gap that we have lost some decades after 1960, and maybe we can become faster even. Mm-hmm. If those which appear to be minor but important things are considered.
Okay, please
follow
it up.
Okay. Thank you. I forgot your question. Is it Emmanuel? Yeah, about the budget sharing absolute. Okay. There are about maybe 10 countries or so that consistently every year are above the 10%. some go in and out, up and down, because depending on what the umbrella is and what's being allocated that year, right? But if you look at it, actually, the goal was the 10%. The absolute levels are very high, almost doubled, right? 86%. Now, if you're coming out of the kind of crisis there were, no schools were being built, no roads were being built, no social services were going anywhere. So when growth came back, the pressure to put money in those more short-term visible things was very high, but also the need was there. So government just spent a lot of money, including almost doubling agricultural outlays, but they could not get the 10% in every case. But there was an increase all over the place, across the countries, right? So, but there are about a dozen that consistently are in the 10% range. The perception of nutrition, behavioral change, nutrition is something you need to know as well. That's just not what you're used to, right? If you don't understand the science behind it, you can nourish yourself wrong, you can nourish yourself right, okay? So yes, culture comes in there, but I think our food habits, our diet change all the time, right? Very few people get the same thing that their, you know, grandparents were eating, right? If you look at how fast food is spreading around the world, right? So it's a matter of making sure that if it's not the taste, at least it's the understanding and the knowledge and the know-how of it. A lot of people would want to eat better and healthy if they knew, right? If you look at among the middle class across Africa, how many now go to the gym and try to live a healthier life? It's because they know that it's better for them, right? So in Senegal, education about diet and diet culture is a big part of their program at the community level. When they weigh kids in the hospitals and bring in the mothers, they teach them about right nutrition for the babies and for themselves. They do demonstration and recipes. If kids are moderately undernourished, actually they organize cooking. They feed them and they bring their parents for about 2 weeks period or so. They sit with them to go through all the ingredients. And they do the cooking. They tell them and teach them how they can use local ingredients for better nutrition. So I think that a better educated person, certainly, I think he has a good program on that, where you're trying to do personalized nutrition. So you empower people with knowledge and know how, I think they'll do a better job at nourishing themselves better. On the research and extension gap, there is, in one of those best practice recommendations, where you strengthen the research and extension system as part of a channel to improve nutrition, because that's how you can get biofortified food, but also help of diversifying the production at the wholesale level. Those are messages that are best vehiculated through the extension system. And if you do it and do it right, it'll work, but you're in a difficult extension system. When it's heavy and government-based, it's very hard to get enough supply because it's just expensive.
Mm-hmm. Usman, thank you for flying overnight and giving a wonderful and informative talk and standing up to the debate. Colleagues, thank you for your active participations. There's more to come in the future. There's the Malabo panel is lining up its next research background paper and panel report, which we expect to present in early fall, September, October. Hopefully we get you come back this month at that time. That will be on mechanization, a hot topic. What does it do for employment, for productivity, mm-hmm. who benefits, what role private sector, and so on. So we at CEF are involved in it, and our network from the HARI project, partners from the University of Hawaii, many African partners. And we are headed for another policy event with the Malabo Montpellier Forum with political leaders to discuss implementation. So
I think we beautifully presented our high level of ambitions, that we don't just do great reports as they are there taken by you, and we don't just have academic debates as we had in Senegal and in Dakar and Cotonou and London in the parliament and so on, and now here, but we want to have outreach to African policymakers. So the music of food, nutrition, security and agriculture improvement is primarily in Africa. Still, it was great to have you here, Usman, and thank you all. Look forward to have you again.